Here we go. Oh my gosh, look at this. It's Monday already, and it's already 6 o'clock in the morning. This is Up North News Radio for this Monday. I'm Pat Kreitlow. Hope you had a very nice weekend. Coming up on the program today, the Barbenheimer Effect. You know, on Mondays, we typically review Up North News stories that get a lot of views and clicks. But if you're going to talk about a lot of views and clicks, you got to talk about the two blockbuster movies that came out this past weekend, Barbie and Oppenheimer. So we'll talk about the larger than already expected outreach from U.S. audiences to that. We will talk about some of the higher clicked stories from the Up North News social media sites with Sherita Booker, including best fish fries in the state, and whether people think that former President Trump's grasp on reality is slipping. Spoiler alert. Also, State Assembly Rep. Alex Joers was one of about 100 state-level leaders from around the country who were invited to the White House last week to discuss ways to make quality childcare more accessible and affordable, especially in light of the immense opposition from an entire American political party to accessible and affordable childcare in the year of our Lord, 2023. Plus more headlines, our daily history lesson, a little music break, our weatherology forecast, and more, all coming up on this Monday edition of Up North News Radio. We get started at 6:06, so if you're not watching us live, you can roll this video ahead 4 minutes. We'll talk to you soon.
Harry's song today is going to be a different old 97 song called Oppenheimer.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go. All right, so we get to play a game this week of will the four-year-old join me as a co-host at some point?
That sounds like a good game.
It would normally, especially if, you know, when he was three and early four, but now he's in this habit of just screaming when he doesn't get what he wants. And so you might hear a blood-curdling scream, and it was just him being told he can't have, you know, cake for breakfast or something. My favorite is not understanding the laws of physics and time. He wants to go back to yesterday when he was on an airplane. I want to go back to yesterday. That's... like, me too, kid, get in line. You know, tell him he can't do that. Yes, we can. So maybe he's the next Oppenheimer. I don't know.
We'll find out.
Yeah.
All across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Well, hey there, Wisconsin. Good morning. Welcome to the State of Wiscommon Sense up here on the shores of Lake Wissota, where it's a beautiful, though smoky day up north. Very smoky, actually. It's 59 degrees up here on the lake on our home base, 93.5 The Tap, along the Civic Media Radio Network on this Monday, July 24th. It is 61 in Green Bay right now. Amory coming in at 59. Madison reporting 62. La Crosse 63. Janesville 63 degrees as well. And again, a combination of fog and mist and smoke and haze, depending on where you are in the state this morning. Here's what's on tap on this Monday. We'll start with the Barbenheimer effect. As we usually do on Mondays, we'll review which Up North news stories are getting the most clicks and views, but we can't overlook the two movies that are dwarfing everything else in summer viewing. So we will check out reaction to Greta Gerwig's Barbie and Christopher Nolan's Oppenheimer. Plus, we will review those more Wisconsin-based views on stories, including who's got the best fish fry in the state, and whether people think former President Trump's grasp on reality might be slipping. Oh, we'll also talk about those monster-sized postcards you might be getting targeting Tammy Baldwin, all about drug prices. And Twitter continues to circle the drain with its latest move overnight. In our second hour, State Representative Alex Joers will join us. He was one of nearly 100 state-level leaders from around the country who were invited to the White House last week to discuss ways to make quality childcare more accessible and affordable. And that's the tease, because to write anything else would mean you have to wonder what historians are going to think when they look back at the year 2023 and how Republicans were against accessible, affordable, quality child care and health care and good wages and fighting pollution. But they are boycotting Barbie. They are shooting cans of Bud Light. They are banning rainbows. So both sides of U.S. politics are equally bad? Maybe? Along the way, we'd love to hear if you saw one or both of the movies over the weekend. We normally have Kristen Lyerly around Mondays at 6:30. She's not able to visit with us on Monday this week. And so we'd love to have some of your phone calls in the 6:30 segment, 844-967-2789. Did you see one of the movies? Did you see both? Was that a good strategy? Which one would you like to see more? We'd love to have your thoughts on all of that, or you can shoot us a note by email, radio@upnorthnewswi.com, or you can comment on Facebook, where we show up on several different pages, the Facebook pages for Up North News, for Civic Media, for Bull Falls Radio, that's in Wausau, and 93.5 The Tap in Chippewa Falls. Our first movie review later this hour will come to us courtesy of Aaron Zommers, who joins us now from Madison. Which one did you go see, Aaron, one or both?
I wanted to go see both, but my weekend ended up being busier than I anticipated, so I only saw Barbie.
So, you know what? I think you're going to have time to see both. I think they're going to be around for a while. Yeah. When you consider that there's the actor's strike and now the writer's strike, and I think these, I don't know the exact movie release calendar, but this might be the biggest of the batch for the foreseeable future.
Yeah, I think so.
Mm-hmm. So we'll hear more about that. And we'd, again, love to have your thoughts on the movies coming up a little bit later on this morning as well. We are in the last week of July. And so we have the Civic Pints blood collection campaign to tell you about. Again, Civic Pints is the hashtag when you give a pint of blood at a reputable blood donation center. You take a selfie, You put that selfie on social media with the hashtag Civic Pints. The social media gurus here at Civic Media will see it and enter you in a drawing that could include brewer's tickets and so much more. And you can learn more at the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us. I was off on Friday. I'll be off again this Friday for our annual big week of having the entire extended family here under one roof. And given how late they tend to stay up, I think none of them are hearing me right now at home underneath the big roof. If so, they're cussing grandpa into his pillow. But see, I've got the way our Wi-Fi network is set up, I get little notices on my phone as different devices join. It's kind of how I knew, you know, like one batch had rolled up into the driveway. Suddenly I got all these pings that these devices had joined the network that had been on there before. And Aaron, I hope you, I don't know if you'll sympathize or laugh along with it, but when I got up at 4:15, I noticed I got a notice that a new Oculus virtual reality goggles device has joined your network 1 hour ago. So at least I know how late the boys downstairs were playing video games, or at least when they started. I'm not sure exactly when they ended, but don't you remember when your summer vacation, you could stay up till the cows come home, you know, whatever it took.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you didn't have the high-tech toys, but still the ability to do that with your summer vacation, I'm a little envious.
It was pretty nice.
Yeah. You know,
I remember those not so distant days for me yet.
Yeah. I mean, those boys are not going to appear upstairs here till lunchtime, but you know, this is their week to just goof off here at grandma grandpa's. We'll go for boat rides and things like that. And it's going to be great, but you know, it does mean that if they're even a little bit susceptible to hearing this radio show early in the morning, well, they know that's on them. When you're putting in your VR goggles at 3 o'clock in the morning. We've got a lot of headlines and things to talk about as well coming up on this Monday edition of Up North News Radio. I'm Pat Kreitlow. We'll be back in just a sec. Wherever you are across Wisconsin right now, you're up north.
I'll be right back.
Okay. Tell you what, let's just jump right into Sherita out of the break, and then I'll do sports and everything else.
Okay.
Cool. Thanks. And it's not just because I'm a little paranoid. I'll forget it like I did last week. So.
If you're coming with me, you need nerves of steel. Cause I take corners on two wheels. But it's a never ending circus ride.
It's always nice to start off the week with Sherita Booker, our social media manager at Up North News. You can find a lot of what she does on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Look for Up North News WI. Don't forget the WI. But also Twitter, or not Twitter. What am I trying to think of here? That other one, TikTok.
TikTok.
Boy, oh boy, Grandpa. Starting off the week strong here. TikTok does not have the WI. Just look for Up North News on there. Sherita, how are you?
Good. How are you, Pat?
All right. Well, let's save the old man here, but we're jumping right into my weirdness to people wondering if Donald Trump's getting weirder. And again, now this is very subjective, but when you compile the list of stories that get the most engagements, the most likes, the most comments, clearly the Kiev Akil story about Trump's kind of off-kilter comments lately, it's getting a lot of attention.
Yeah. So earlier this week, Trump suggested that President Joe Biden's son, Hunter Biden, should get the death penalty for paying his taxes late. He also called President Biden a crackhead.
Well, this from a guy who, like Kia notes, has never shied away from personal attacks, from ugly attacks, but there just seems to be more of a tone of desperation in this. I mean, this is somebody who's been indicted twice already. Appears to be much more to come. But this is also a guy who, going back to Barack Obama, he was one of the original big spreaders of the birther lie. And I mean, he's even his tweet led to, wasn't it like somebody showing up at the former president's home because of a Trump post?
I believe so.
I mean, he showed up armed, you know. This is somebody whose behavior got him kicked off social media. And then he had to form his own little tiny social media company. And I think a lot of folks hoped he would, you know, ride into the sunset, but that's doesn't look like that's going to be the case at all. Comments are going both ways, I would imagine.
Absolutely. And people are so used to him speaking recklessly, like that some of this comes to no surprise.
No, it doesn't. But clearly it is something that people still want to engage with one way or the other. And so that's an article that you'll find on our website at upnorthnewswi.com. Next on the list, this one's somewhat troubling to me. This is, again, about AI, artificial intelligence, which, I mean, it sounded so theoretical like just a year ago, and now it seems like it's almost everywhere. And not everybody's happy with what AI does when you put things in, although I would say, you know, garbage in, garbage out. So when you put in, you know, something that looks like it's going to come out as a caricature, don't be surprised when it does. What are we talking about in this instance?
Okay, so BuzzFeed asked AI what Europeans think Americans look like in every state. And you guys have to head over to our Instagram or Facebook to check out what they think Wisconsinites look like. So the image is of an overweight man sitting at a table with several types of cheeses and looks like a 40 ounce of beer.
Yep. Yep. You know, wearing a toque, you know, and he's got the flannel over the T-shirt, which is probably a Packer T-shirt. But I mean, and he's not just overweight. I mean, this man is morbidly obese and, you know, kind of making a face at the camera. And again, when I say garbage in, garbage out, I mean, when you ask people, in this case, ask Europeans what they think Americans look like in various states, you know, don't be surprised when you get that, because people like to give, you know, smart aleck answers. And, you know, the comments in there, I'm sure some of them took issue, and I'm sure others probably pointed to people from other states.
Yeah. And it's very stereotypical. So people weren't happy about what they felt like they suggested of some people from Wisconsin. But yeah, there's other states in there we have people from Illinois, Texas, that or what they think they look like. So you got to head over and take a look at that.
Oh, yeah. I was just looking at those ones right now. And again, they're funny pictures. So as long as people take it as an exercise in humor and try to keep a tongue in cheek, or in this case, a hunk of cheese, you know, in cheek, I guess that we will be okay. All right. It's time again for the match game. We've been doing this, feels like, for a couple of weeks now. And both Christina talks about it from, you know, the uplift segment of stories coming up in the newsletter, or graphics or stories. And then people see these as you post them on social media, and they love to provide their input. What do we got this time around?
So we did a fill in the blank last week, and we asked you what your favorite fish fry was in Wisconsin.
And very deliberate. Blank yes. has the best fish fry in Wisconsin. And you know, you word it that way as you did so well, people go and jump in.
Yeah. So there were so many options. Like, I don't even think I really saw too many repeats, but I did see a couple people say Culver's.
I actually just had that last night.
Right. Like, it's cool if you don't want to go get some to-go food from a restaurant, but I have my own personal favorite at in Milwaukee Public Market. It's called St. Paul's Fish Company, and they have really great perch.
All right. I got a guy here named Nate who gets a gold star for putting down my dad. Which that was very nice. But I mean, look through these, and I'm just reading random ones here. The Eagles Club in Merrill, there's Pine Ridge in Stone Lake, there's Helsing's Bar up in Radisson, Cousins and Haugen, Kate's Bar in Barron. You've got places in Loganville, Thorpe, Stoddard, Plum City, Friendship, Merrill, Wabino. This is amazing. And honestly, it would take a lot of work, but we could do worse than to make a map or even a guidebook out of this and tell people, you know, go get a stamp from as many of these places as you can. And, but don't go to all of them. You'll end up looking like the guy in the AI cartoon.
Oh no, don't make that come true.
No, but yeah, so many great options. I hope folks go look at that, especially the Facebook version of that post. And for that, just go over to UpNorth News WI. Sharita Booker, thanks so much, as always, for kicking off our day with letting us know what people are looking at. We appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
All right, now let's jump into the Brewers update from over the weekend, taking on the Atlanta Braves. And while the Brewers were looking good until the eighth inning, it only took one swing of the bat for the Brewers to miss out on a stellar pitching performance by starter Julio Teheran, who went six innings, giving up just one run on three hits. But reliever Elvis Pagrero's first pitch to Atlanta's Ozzie Albies in the eighth inning was a three-run homer, and it erased the Brewers' 2-1 lead and led to yesterday's 4-3 loss. So the Braves took two out of three over the weekend, but they are still your first place Milwaukee Brewers by a half game over Cincinnati. And look who's here for games tonight, tomorrow, and Wednesday afternoon. Yep, the Cincinnati Reds. Colin Ray will get the start tonight at American Family Field. You can hear the Brewers in the Richland Center area on WRCE News from the Center, 107.7 FM, 1450 AM. If you're going through the Fox Valley, and you might be for the EAA Air Ventures Show, well, you can hear the Brewers on Oshkosh Air Support, 98.3 and 1100 AM. And that reminds me, the EAA Air Venture Show is at the top of our, well, it's basically the entire newsletter from the Up North News folks, Christina Laurie and others. There will be an article on the top things to see in Oshkosh this week. Also, the world's greatest aviation celebration couldn't happen without thousands of volunteers taking on roles, big and small. Christina Laurie will have a story sitting down with us tomorrow about one special volunteer as she joins us on the program. But again, that newsletter you can sign up for at our website, upnorthnewswi.com. So be on the look for that. And of course, as Sharita just mentioned, UpNorthNewsWI for all things social media that we're putting out as well. All right. Among the headlines I wanted to get to, because I got a second one in as many weeks, was one of these giant postcards. Maybe you get them as well. It's got, it's not election time, but here it is, the, you know, black and white picture of Tammy Baldwin as a thumbnail. And then you've got, you know, grandpa's looking a little concerned. He's on the phone. That's because on the backside, it says here, while the Biden administration blocks access to life-saving drugs, 28 Senate Democrats want to give government even more control over your health care. Tell Senator Baldwin to abandon the Smart Prices Act now. Paid for by the 60-plus Association. What is the 60-plus Association, and what is the Smart Prices Drug Act? I'm sure they think they're getting a lot of mileage with these giant postcards. So let's look into this, shall we? The 60-plus Association was founded in 1992 as a seniors advocacy group with a free enterprise, less government, less taxes approach to senior issues. They describe themselves as the conservative alternative to the AARP. 60 Plus has sought to privatize Social Security and the federal estate tax, because billionaires need fewer taxes, right? And strengthen gun rights. That's apparently a big priority for the 60 plus conservative set. They oppose aspects of healthcare reform, federal energy standards, and tax increases, according to the website DSmog. They spent millions of dollars trying to tell people in 2009 that the Affordable Care Act would cause people to lose access to doctors, treatments, and life-saving drugs. And so what is this Smart Prices Act that these conservative elders are so opposed to? Well, it has to do with the Inflation Reduction Act. And we've talked a few times on the program here about how Medicare, starting very, very soon, can finally use its bulk pricing power to negotiate for lower prices for you, for your prescription drugs. That should have been a gimme in 2003, 20 years ago, when Medicare Part D was created, but Republicans set it up to say that Medicare could not negotiate with Big Pharma. The drug companies had much more power to set the prices, and guess where they set the prices, and guess what that did to profits, and guess what it did to seniors' pocketbooks. And so now, all these years later, Democrats over the past 2 years, when they controlled both houses of Congress, were able to finally end that ban. And the Smart Pricing Act, the point of this giant postcard, is something that Senator Tammy Baldwin and other Senate Democrats have sponsored that would say, okay, it's fine that they can do that for some prescription drugs. How about more? How about more prescription drugs and biologics and others? And not just for, you know, people Medicare, you know, 65 plus, but maybe 50 plus. Again, all under the guise of something most conservatives claim to be in favor of. Capitalism is all about the economics of the market having to pay for prices based on things like buying in bulk. You buy more, you pay less. And yet, for some reason, the 60 Plus Association and others do not want you to have that bulk pricing freedom on behalf of the government when it's negotiating prices for seniors who have worked their entire lives and now count on Medicare for the things they need to keep them healthy and save their lives. All right, coming up next, we'd love to have your phone calls. If you saw either Barbie or Oppenheimer over the weekend, we'll get Aaron's review on one of those movies. We'll talk about just how many people went to go see them. We'll also talk about Twitter continuing to circle the drain and so much more still ahead on this Monday morning on Up North News Radio. We'll be back in just a bit.
Wow, that's a bunch of hooey, that mailer you got.
I know.
I can't believe that a 60 plus, like, someone who claims to be advocating for senior issues would be like, making these drugs cheaper.
I don't want that.
They're blocking them. Mm-hmm. And I don't want that.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I think that association might just be Ron Johnson. What with the privatizing Social Security emphasis?
Oh, definitely. Oops. I have to stop hitting that. Gotta tape this cord up better.
Follow Up North News online anytime. Search Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter for Up North News WI and our homepage, upnorthnewswi.com.
This is Aerosmith, and we'll talk more in a few minutes about why we're talking about that particular Beatles remake and a few others coming up in our daily music break and history lesson. We also played Pam Tillis a little earlier. We'll tell you why again coming up in just about 15 minutes or so. But first, we've got to talk movies. We've got to talk Barbie. We've got to talk Oppenheimer. And if you would like to share your own thoughts on one or the other or both, 844-967-2789 is your chance to tell folks all across Wisconsin that they should or should not see it because there was something you liked about it. No spoiler alerts. We just don't know if we won the war and if, you know, Barbie continued to be popular with Ken. But those spoiler alerts notwithstanding, Barbenheimer, as people are calling the mashup, was a spinner of box office gold. The Associated Press writes, Greta Gerwig's Barbie and Christopher Nolan's Oppenheimer brought moviegoers back to the theaters in record numbers this weekend, vastly overperforming the already glowing projections and giving a glimmer of hope to the lagging business amid a sobering backdrop of strikes, which leads me to ask, is this the final big weekend for Hollywood executives that are trying to find some way to crush writers and replace them with AI and outlast, you know, actors and, of course, the directors and everybody else who, by and large, supports, you know, the human beings who are working in the Hollywood industry? Which of those movies got the top spot? Probably not difficult to guess that it was Barbie, done by Warner Brothers. A massive $155 million in ticket sales from North American theaters, surpassing the Super Mario Brothers movie and every other Marvel movie this year as the biggest opening of the year, and breaking the first weekend record for a film directed by a woman. Meanwhile, Oppenheimer from Universal also soared past expectations, taking in $80 million, marking Nolan's biggest non-Batman debut and one of the best ever starts for an R-rated motion picture. Sorry, I lost my place there. An R-rated biographical drama. It's also the first time ever that one movie opened to more than $100 million and another movie opened to more than $80 million in the same weekend. When it's all settled, it'll likely turn out to be the fourth biggest box office weekend of all time, with about $300 million industry-wide spent on movie tickets this past weekend, all in a marketplace that is increasingly curving toward an intellectual property-driven winner-take-all battle between executives and the people who put these movies together. The Barbenheimer phenomenon may have started as a good-natured competition between two aesthetic opposites, but as many hoped, both movies benefited in the end. The only real casualty, the AP says, is Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 1, which, despite strong reviews and a healthy opening weekend, fell 64% in its second weekend, adding only about $20 million in additional sales this past weekend, still bringing its domestic total after two weekends to $119 million. The president of Warner Brothers Domestic Distribution, Jeff Goldstein, says, "It is a joyous time in the world. This is history in so many ways. I think this marketing campaign is one for the ages that people will be talking about forever." Which raises a good question. Was it the marketing campaign that actually got people in to watch the movie, or were people going to go see one or the other of these anyway? It's all about, how much do you build up expectations? Mr. Zommers, you did take in the Barbie movie. You will eventually get to Oppenheimer. So why don't you be first to share with us the Civic Media Radio Network review of the Barbie movie?
It was good.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate that. Okay, I'm just going to sip my coffee while you try to think of some other words to say about it.
Yeah, I have other words. So first of all, the right-wingers who are boycotting the movie, it's probably for the best, because if they go, they're just going to get very angry and probably disrupt things, because it is not subtle and it's very feminist. So earlier when you said, "Is Barbie still interesting to Ken?" I was like, clearly you haven't seen it.
I guess not. Okay.
Because at the beginning, it says that, every day is an amazing day in Barbie land for Barbie, because she wakes up, she says hi to all her homegirls. They all hang out and run the world, being, astronauts, physicists, mm-hmm. the president, all these other things. Ken only has a good day if Barbie looks at him.
Yeah, that sums up the fragility of today's male ego on parts of some people very, very well. I like this. We'll come back to your full review in a minute, but it reminded me that somebody got all the comments from furious men on the interwebs who gave one-star reviews of Barbie and took a portion of their venom and put it up on a Barbie poster. So, the ads where it's the movie poster, but then a critic's review is highlighted, across the top of it. Here are some of them. Just imagine every one of them is on a Barbie poster, and there's Ryan Gosling and Margot Robbie as Barbie and Ken, the big Barbie logo at the top, a beautiful blue sky, and it says, "Barbie, an alienating, dangerous, and perverse film," says one man who gave it one stars. Here's another one. "Barbie, the feminist agenda will kill us all." Here's another. "Barbie, they won't be happy until we are all gay." And one more. "Barbie, a pink acid trip that feels like being slapped by lots of confusingly attractive people." The fact that anybody would take the time to go and give Barbie a one-star review and then put something like that up, just I don't know what's in their head to crave that kind of attention from a certain subset of humanity.
I think I do. It's just like when somebody is told, like, white people are responsible for these atrocities. And they're like, but I'm white and I didn't do it. And they get mad and defensive. Mm-hmm. It's just the same thing in this movie where it says negative things, whether directly or implying them, about men and their role in society. And they're like, but I'm a man and I'm not this insufferable. Yes, you are.
Yeah, actually, Ken, we can be the equivalent of Karen. Did we ever come up with a male equivalent of that in this day and age? Yeah.
I don't know, but if this movie is anything to go by, I think we can use Ken.
Okay. Okay. See, now I'm intrigued. I know I was going to see it anyway, because like I said, both daughters are in town this week. They both very much grew up on Barbie. So I'm sure that'll be coming along. If any of you saw it and would like to tell us what you think of, is your review in line with Aaron's on the Barbie movie? 844-967-2789. And I'm also interested in some of the reaction to the Oppenheimer movie, because it gets to that whole notion of, you know, the nuclear bomb, the atomic bomb, and developing it. And of course, whether using it was necessary to end the war in Japan. And I'm sure there's a bit of a morality tale in there. And it seems like there are folks that are trying to engage in, I don't know the right term for it, not revisionist history, but they want to isolate the horrors of the bomb and separate it from all that had happened up to that point, that there was still a world war going on. And did they treat that debate, fairly? And again, fairly is subjective, but I'd love to know people's thoughts on that as they go along too. And I don't know if that's part of what interests you about the movie, Aaron, or if it's just simply the drama of racing the clock to get this thing developed before, the Nazis or the Soviets or anybody else.
Yeah, that's definitely also part of it. There is a lot going on in the world at the time. And one thing that I've been seeing a lot online on what is currently still known as Twitter is that the narrative that we hear about the testing of the atomic bomb in New Mexico is that, it was a big uninhabited space, mm-hmm. when that's not entirely true, and that a lot of people were forced out of the area without really being given any other option.
Good. I'm glad you mentioned that, because that was going to be my next point as well, is it's not just the impact on people in Japan, but yes, in the desert. And also, I was reading for the history segment today about the post-war atomic testing that went on in the South Pacific on Bikini Island and others. And it's, again, it's not like it was entirely uninhabited, so you can't pretend those folks didn't exist. There was an impact.
Yeah, and from, I don't know if the movie addresses that. I imagine not, because that's not the focus, mm-hmm. but I think it's something that we should be aware of.
Well, it will continue to be debated in places like Twitter, or do we say X? Are they changing the name to X, or is that just the new logo instead of the bird in overnight developments here?
Well, if you go to x.com, it reroutes you to Twitter. So I think they're changing the name.
Seriously, x.com? Yep. Oh, boy. All right. So yeah, overnight, another one of the headlines that I woke up to was noting that Elon Musk has replaced the friendly blue bird that had been a Twitter logo, from the beginning, in a major rebranding of the platform that he bought for $44 million last year. He replaced it with a white X on a black background. And let's see if there's any description here. Musk had asked fans for logo ideas. He described it as minimalist art deco that will be refined, and soon we shall bid adieu to the Twitter brand and gradually all the birds.
Elon Musk, this is not going to fix your idiocy and your inability to operate a global social media platform.
He loves the letter X, of course. He gave a space X. He founded a company, a startup called X.com that later would become known as PayPal. He loves to collect things with the letter X on there. And I guess I read someplace once that he was told in one of these early meetings that, X was a stupid idea. And then he's been, he's been cheesed off about that ever since, and is
oh, I'm sure
determined to change everything. And he has certainly changed Twitter. And I am not joking one bit that X marks the spot where Twitter is circling the drain. It's been shedding users. It has been a failure by any measure of a corporate acquisition. While Threads had a massive first couple of weeks, things have stabled off there, but it is very much an alternative now to Twitter. And so this is why we can't have nice things, because egotistical billionaires have to come in and spend their money to either ruin platforms that were disseminating news or buying elections or whatever the case may be. This is what we're facing now, is a world where we need to escape, either in the adventures of a doll like Barbie, or we need to escape into the adventures of racing to develop the atomic bomb, because there's not as much that's nearly happy and joyful to talk about. Hey, we will even take solace in thinking about the author Ernest Hemingway, going back that far, in part because a white bearded man from Wisconsin won the National Hemingway Lookalike Contest in Key West over the weekend here. Garrett Marshall is a retired broadcast engineer from Madison who prevailed on Saturday night at Sloppy Joe's Bar, a frequent hangout of Hemingway when he lived in Key West during the 1930s. Aaron, I know you've seen, if you haven't seen pictures of this particular contest, you've seen Ernest Hemingway enough times to know, I don't know why we even bother to have a contest when it feels like, I don't know, every fifth guy in the Midwest kind of looks like Ernest Hemingway with the thinning silver hair and the gray beard. It's exactly a unique look, you know?
Yeah, it does kind of seem pointless.
I mean, I'm looking at the photo of the finalists, including the fellow from Madison. And again, they would all aptly describe themselves as devastatingly handsome, but any one of them could have won the contest, I guess is what I'm trying to say. So congratulations to Garrett Marshall, who not only won it, but won it on his 68th birthday. So good work out of you. Let's take a break for today's history lesson and music break. All coming up in just a bit. You're up north.
I mean, Elon Musk, the names of his kids he's had with Grimes even have X's in them. I don't remember how you say it. XA Archangel A12, some crap like that. And then Exa, what was it? Yeah, Exa Dark Sidrail Musk.
Okay.
And like, come on. If you're naming your children that, you are you're committing child abuse.
Yeah.
In my personal opinion.
Mm-hmm. For the uninitiated, this would be Earth, Wind, and Fire. Sounding nothing like the Beatles original, but a really nice song in its own right, and pretty sure it was a Grammy Award-winning tune as well. It was on the soundtrack to the film Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. The attempt to tell the story of a few Beatles songs became a film that opened on this day in 1978, and it tanked hard. It was savaged by critics. It became a legendary Hollywood flop, even though it had Earth, Wind, and Fire, the Bee Gees, Aerosmith, who we played earlier with a Beatles tune, Billy Preston, Peter Frampton. It was directed by Michael Schultz. It starred an ensemble cast led by Peter Frampton and the Bee Gees, depicting the loosely constructed story of a band as they wrangle with the music industry and battle evil forces bent on stealing their instruments and corrupting their hometown of Heartland. There were songs provided as dialogue to carry the story. Most of the spoken lines that clarified the plot were passed on by George Burns. So maybe, again, George Burns, great comedic actor, especially from the, you know, black and white era. Guess he couldn't quite carry a Beatles-themed movie. However, the Aerosmith and Earth, Wind, and Fire cover tunes of Beatles tunes did all right and live on to this day. That was 1978. Let's go back a couple of years. The number one song this day in 1976 was from the Manhattans.
Let's just kiss and say goodbye.
To meet you here today.
The Dust Bowl heat wave was reaching its peak on this week in 1935. Temperatures hit 104 in Milwaukee, 109 in Chicago. This is the anniversary of the infamous pine tar incident of 1983, when George Brett, playing for the Kansas City Royals, had a game-winning home run nullified after the New York Yankees challenged the amount of pine tar that was on his bat. The number one song this day in 1982 came to us from the movie Rocky III by Survivor. Do we really need to play anything else from this song? You'll know, right? Eye of the Tiger. Michael Richards is 74 years old today, the actor, comedian, Kramer. Linda Carter, Wonder Woman from the 1970s, is in the 70s herself now. Linda Carter is 72 years old today. Singer Pam Tillis, we heard from her earlier. She is 66 today. And we'll hear a little bit later on from Jennifer Lopez, Jenny from the Block, actress, singer, dancer, is 54 years old today. And in this week in 1987, the somewhat fictionalized biography of Latin rock star Richie Valens opened in the U.S. with this theme. It was generally well received, especially the soundtrack by Los Lobos there. Lou Diamond Phillips starred as Valens, who died in the infamous plane crash that killed Buddy Holly and the Big Bopper. Should have noted a few minutes earlier there, when talking about the Beatles, it was on this day in 1967. The Beatles took out a full-page ad in the Times of London calling for the legalization of marijuana. It was in response to a friend of theirs being sentenced to 9 months in jail for marijuana possession. The Beatles' full-page ad said that, quote, "The law against marijuana is immoral in principle and unworkable in practice." Something I was not familiar with till reading about it to see what happened on this particular day in history.
Perhaps unfamiliar, but certainly unsurprised.
Oh yeah. No, there's that was not the surprise. The surprise is that I hadn't heard about it before. I was my inner history nerd was not treating me nicely, to be honest there. Let's see, over the time that I'd taken the long weekend, we had headlines as well about a potential Republican Senate candidate story at the heart of an article by Dan Bice of the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel with the headline, possible U.S. Senate candidate cannot explain his spotty voting record, his positions on gun control, and diversity, equity, and inclusion. And it was all about a suburban Milwaukee businessman, Scott Mayer, who has said that if he runs for Senate, and he's not really sure he wants to run, especially if he's the only one willing to step up, but he might be willing to step up, he says. But he says if so, he'll be a different type of candidate. And that's true in some ways when, as Bice notes, Mayer hasn't voted in many recent elections. He didn't vote in the 2020 presidential election or the 2020 presidential primary. He said he couldn't even recall whether he voted or not. He has given money to numerous Republican presidential candidates over the past 20 years, except former President Donald Trump. He's written on social media that people with mental illnesses should not own guns, but when asked, was not able to say whether he favors stricter background checks. And in the past, Mayer has been a big advocate for diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives in private business, but is unclear whether others should do it as well. Or as he said to Bice, if it works for business, why wouldn't it work in other places? I would think so, but you know, Dan, I'm not even a candidate for anything, right? Which is, you know, kind of code for there have been no consultants or handlers to help gussy up my responses to pretty basic questions like this. So Mayer has said previously he doesn't want to run because he's the only one left, but that is certainly a possibility. He didn't vote in 2018's gubernatorial election between Republican incumbent Scott Walker and Democrat Tony Evers. He sat out the primary and the general in the U.S. Senate races won by Tammy Baldwin, the same person that he might be challenging in 2024. And, you know, Mayer said at the time he didn't have any excuses. He said he didn't consider casting an absentee ballot, and he only recently began taking an interest in a possible political career. So it's not like he was making sure he had a spotless record. Well, that misses the point. You don't vote in every election because you might run for something someday and you want to have a spotless voting record. You vote every time as a matter of citizenship, as a matter of having a say into who is going to be your senator, who is going to be your president. There's more to democracy than writing checks, but he has written checks. He's given more than $125,000 to Republican candidates, including $20,000 to conservative Supreme Court candidate Dan Kelly this last time around. So he's aware of politics. He has a passing interest in it, but is still working to refine the positions if indeed he decides to challenge Tammy Baldwin next year. Much more in our next hour, including a White House visit from a Wisconsin legislator about affordable daycare next. You're up north. All right, if you're good, I'm going to step away for a minute.
Sounds good.
Breaking news overnight about the U.S. soldier who crossed into North Korea for the
testing.
All right, let's see. What are we listening to here?
I just realized I had you muted this whole time.
Oh, that's okay.
Sorry about that.
Let's see.
I've come to realize yesterday and today that I can't record anything in Audition on this computer yet. That's an issue.
Yeah, that would be.
All across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Well, that would be me, and welcome back to the second hour of Up North News Radio for this Monday, July 24th. Nice to have you along here. Coming up, State Assembly Rep Alex Joers was among nearly 100 state-level leaders from around the country who were invited to the White House last week to discuss ways to make quality childcare more accessible and affordable. And we will look forward to talking with the representative coming up at the bottom of this hour. As a reminder, if you missed our last hour where we talked about the Barbenheimer Effect and more, you can catch us as a podcast. You can either subscribe at all the usual places, Apple, Spotify, etc., or you can go to the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us, where every show that's produced by Civic Media is turned into podcasts, and you can listen on an hour-by-hour basis to each episode. And again, we'd love to have you along either live on all these Civic Media radio stations or through our Facebook pages or podcast, however you want to do it. It's great to have you along here for Up North News Radio, with a reminder that Up North News is a separate entity from Civic Media, but we are pleased as punch that they allow us to visit with you from 6 to 8 every morning and talk about what all we do. Sharita Booker, our social media manager, was on in the last hour to talk about some of the most clicked Up North news stories of the past week. And tomorrow morning at 6:30, Christina Laurie will have the uplift, some of the uplifting stories that she puts in our daily newsletter, which comes out about 5 a.m. every weekday. You can sign up for that newsletter at upnorthnewswi.com. Over on our website, if you missed our recent radio segment about it, we tell you all about the state's new Green Ribbon Commission on clean energy and environmental innovation, and how it's going to administer a Green Innovation Fund. That's a mix of both public and private dollars to invest in new projects that will reduce energy costs, it will reduce pollution, they will expand access to energy that is environmentally clean and affordable. We talked to Assembly Representative Katrina Shanklin about that recently, and you'll learn much more in the story on our website at upnorthnewswi.com. The big story this week in Wisconsin is the EAA Air Venture celebration for 2023, which makes Oshkosh the world's busiest airport for a time. And it's something where, as I look at this article from Fox 11 in Green Bay, hundreds of thousands of visitors will come from all over the world. Last year, that included 2,000 international guests from 92 different countries and six continents. And Dick Napinski, the EAA Director of Communications, said that they could very well top that total again this year as people come along to, you know, celebrate all things aviation. And again, that international number only takes into consideration the folks who check in at the international visitors tent. It's just become a tradition for some families who, again, come from countries all over the world. And Fox 11 has that up on their website. And obviously Oshkosh Air Support and others here at Civic Media will be talking about this, you know, throughout the coming days, and celebrating everything that is about Air Venture. In somewhat more serious news, but it's something I feel like we should take a little bit of time on, it's, again, the whole notion of whitewashing history. And yet another egregious example from Ron DeSantis' Florida. What he and others have done to that state is nothing short of criminal, including crimes against history. His State Board of Education, according to an article in the Washington Post,
has unveiled its new standards for the instruction of African American history in public schools. And this editorial talks about some of the more horrendous elements of it. They will now teach students that the slavery system, which was once constitutionally protected in this country, in which enslavers bought and sold human beings, according to Ron DeSantis's Florida Board of Education, there was an upside to all of that. In addition to being subjected to, you know, murder, rape, beatings, being maimed, enslaved Black people, quote, developed skills which in some instances could be applied for their personal benefit. So, as the editorial notes, Florida's children will now learn that slavery was in part a beneficial job training program, and that Black Americans share the blame for the violence that white mobs inflicted upon their communities. What DeSantis is doing here, in his words, would be a crusade against woke indoctrination, when what it really is the continued indoctrination of white supremacy through the continued whitewashing of what really happened in American history, including the, you know, the unsavory parts of it. And as we discussed in our last hour, then continuing to indoctrinate some white people into thinking that this is an attack on them or an attack on grandpa, when this is really about history and the real things that happened and the real positives that all people, white, Black, and otherwise, can have on the future, but only if we're willing to be honest about the past. When we come back, we're going to have an update on the Brewers taking on the Atlanta Braves over the weekend as they head into another home series this week against the Cincinnati Reds. We'll also get the full weatherology forecast and much more later on in this hour. We'll also talk about affordable daycare next. You're up north. That would be Jennifer Lopez. The birthday girl is 54 years old today, actress, singer, and dancer with her first top 10 hit.
Time for an update on the weatherology forecast. And as I was noticing around Wisconsin, you know, the temperatures, there were a lot of reports of fog or haze or mist. In the Chippewa Valley, it quite clearly said the conditions were smoky, and it was really telling in these early morning hours, and of course all day yesterday as well. So we are far from done with the wildfire smoke and, you know, everything that it's been doing to us in Wisconsin and across the upper tier of states. But let's find out more about the fog, the haze, the heat. It's going to be a hot one this week. And Jennifer Wojcicki from Weatherology joins us now to give us all the details on the full Wisconsin forecast for this Monday. Jennifer, good morning.
Good morning. Yeah, and as you mentioned, it does look like an air quality alert is in effect for much of the state today as that smoke from the Canadian wildfires makes its way through. So definitely something to keep in mind today with the areas of smoke and haze. Otherwise, sunny skies beyond that for most today. A slight chance for showers and thunderstorms develop for central and west central Wisconsin this afternoon, with a blend of clouds and sunshine developing as well. Slight chance for storms into the evening hours for those areas too, with a marginal risk for severe weather. So definitely something we'll keep you posted on throughout the day today. Highs in the mid to upper 80s primarily, 90s around southwestern Wisconsin. Tuesday, mid to upper 80s for southern Wisconsin, Milwaukee to Madison, then 90s expected for Richland Center up towards Wisconsin Rapids and for western Wisconsin as well. Sunny skies tomorrow with some areas of lingering smoke around Wausau and Oshkosh. Wednesday, slight chance for showers and storms for most, except for around Amory and Baldwin, where they will expect to have sunny skies for the day, upper 80s to low 90s across the board. 90s expected for Thursday with sunny skies, and then by Friday, looks like a hot day though slightly cooler, back to the into the mid to upper 80s from Amory to Oshkosh and down to Milwaukee, lingering around about 90 from Waukesha over to Richland Center, with a chance for showers and storms for everyone on Friday as well.
All right, Jennifer, thank you so much. Appreciate it. Hope you have a great day.
You too.
There's Jennifer Wojcicki from Weatherology joining us. It's 62 degrees up here in Chippewa Falls. Madison reporting 61, Oshkosh 64, and Hayward, folks listening to the Buzz of the North, 63 degrees there right now. The Milwaukee Brewers unfortunately messed up a great starting performance by Julio Teheran. He went six innings, gave up one run on three hits, but the bullpen was not able to hold on despite a stellar performance of late by the bullpen. But all it took was reliever Elvis Peguero's first pitch to Atlanta's Ozzie Albies in the eighth inning, and that three-run homer erased a Brewers 2-1 lead, and eventually the Brewers would lose to Atlanta 4-3. The Braves took two out of three over the weekend, though the Brewers are still in first place in the National League Central Division, up by a half game over Cincinnati. And those same Cincinnati Reds are here. Yes, another series against the Reds taking place at American Family Field tonight and tomorrow night and Wednesday afternoon. Colin Ray will get the start tonight. Over at Oshkosh Air Support, 98.3 FM, 1100 AM. That's where you can hear the Brewers in the Fox Valley. And if you're in the Richland Center area, tune in to WRCE News from the Center, 107.7 FM and 1450 AM. Coming up in 15 minutes, just under 15 minutes, Representative Alex Joers will be here to talk about affordable daycare. It's something that we've talked about quite frequently here on the program, in part out of a sense of disbelief, maybe, that you could have an entire political class that is against affordable daycare for working families, even as they continue to try to talk about economic development and jobs, but you can't really separate the two. And Representative Joers will tell us more about that coming up in our second half hour. But in terms of the workplace and how we continue to move into a post-pandemic period, there was a story late last week from Tom Dakin at the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel talking about how downtowns all over America, and I would dare say around the world, have faced a decline in office workers as so many more people found new workplaces, either at home or in the suburbs or other areas. But in Milwaukee, you have a downtown that is outpacing its peers when it comes to people returning to the office, at least part of the time. Part of it is that downtowns are looking to rework their streets for cycling and walking. They're looking to create more public spacing, according to new research from the University of Toronto. And
in rankings compiled by the university, Milwaukee has one of the nation's better downtown recovery rates. They do that by measuring mobile phone data at downtown restaurants, stores, and other points of interest in more than 60 U.S. and Canadian cities, so that you not only get a sense of how downtown is attracted to employees, but to visitors and to shoppers as well. And downtown Milwaukee's activity level from December to February was at 76% of the level prior to the pandemic. The average let me rephrase that. It was 76% of its level prior to the pandemic. Salt Lake City was at 139% because of a big influx of new residents. Meanwhile, you have San Francisco, which is only seeing 32% of its pandemic level visitors and workers, as many tech workers continue to work remotely. Milwaukee ranks 16th out of the 63 North American cities that were measured. And again, it's not that everybody's coming back to the office full time, the article notes, but that there is some hybrid activity that probably is the best of both worlds. You know, the workplace is changing more than ever. I even noticed this weekend through Civic Media that the radio station group continues to build nice new studios. Obviously, we've talked about the one on State Street that is now opened up down in Madison, so that poor Aaron is not broadcasting from a tiny closet. He's now broadcasting from a larger, much more beautiful closet, and we appreciate that. And I know Aaron does as well. Mostly, Aaron, you appreciate where you are, yes?
Oh, absolutely.
That just kind of, yes, yes, I love being here. Yes, please continue my paychecks. Yes, sir. But did you happen to see in one of the Civic Media boards the new photos from Chippewa Falls? That was probably just in one of the other channels there. But
no, I did not see those.
So the Chippewa Falls studio is coming along nicely downtown. It won't be ready for a while. The construction is done, but you still have to put in, a control board and hook up all the other bells and whistles. And don't we know a thing or two about the challenge that brought just to the State Street location? It's one thing to build it. It's another thing to wire it.
Yeah, and the engineering team has a couple, two, three stations to worry about this in. You know, only like 18 stations across the state or somewhere in that vicinity. Who knows? The number keeps growing.
Which again, I will say, as not a Civic Media employee, is still pretty damn cool that somebody's coming along and taking these radio stations and investing in local radio and giving people a place to produce Wisconsin-based content. That part's pretty awesome. So eventually we'll see the Chippewa Falls one as well. But again, that's the construction. My overall point being the hybrid activity of working for me right now is a home office. And it's great, but it's no studio. I can't have another person here. There's a lot of things that I can't do here. But I like having the option to do the show from home or from on the road. And we're just going to continue to see more of that as people might still have a downtown hub. There might still be a downtown location, but it really is going to be up to the employers themselves to set up a model that works best and not just to demand everybody come back to the office just because they have to. I think that we've already shown from the reaction of workers who, vote with their feet and vote with their resumes and vote with their 2-week notices, that isn't always necessarily a healthy thing for a workplace to do. But Milwaukee, between the lakefront and some of the other amenities, it's working out quite nicely so far. So congrats to Milwaukee for continuing to be an attractive place to live and work, no matter what your own state's legislative leaders want to tell you. No matter how much people who don't live in Milwaukee try to demonize Milwaukee and Madison and other big cities, the residents of Wisconsin cities have proven quite ably that they like where they are. They like the amenities that are here, as are the ones in the small towns. And look, we're not going to get back into the whole Jason Aldean, try that in a small town controversy. We addressed that back last Thursday. But the fact of the matter is we all get to, again, vote with our feet far more often, and Milwaukee continues to prove that
Wisconsin cities are great places in which to live and work. And for that, we should all be quite thankful. I wanted to just give a brief mention of a guest coming up this week. We're scheduled for Hans Breitenmoser tomorrow. We'll have Kristen Lyerly on Thursday with Hometown Health. On Wednesday, well, first, as usual, in our first hour, we'll have Melissa Baldoff with our weekly climate check. But we've got a special guest Wednesday at 7:30, an author who is going to be joining us to talk about a particular era in American history and the impact that was had here in Wisconsin as well as Minnesota. And it primarily is about the Minnesota side of things because of the new book that just came out called Into the Bright Sunshine, written by Samuel Friedman. And it talks about Hubert Humphrey's speech to the 1948 Democratic National Convention. And you may say, why? Why are we talking about the 1948 Democratic Convention? Well, first off, because it's the 75th anniversary of it. Second, because Hubert Humphrey's speech, and he was a complete unknown outside the city of Minneapolis at that point. He was the young mayor of Minneapolis in 1948. But he gave such a rousing speech that did so much to turn the Democratic Party from the segregationist party of the many decades prior into the party that embraced civil rights. And you had, again, something that was a case of Republicans had been more likely to support civil rights. And so we will talk to, you know, our guest coming up, Samuel Friedman, on Wednesday morning about Wisconsin's Republican senator back there in the 40s and 50s, Alexander Wiley, from here in Chippewa Falls. Our other senator was a guy named Joseph McCarthy. And so we'll ask him all about, you know, how other Democrats reacted to Hubert Humphrey and other people pushing the party to finally embrace civil rights. And so Samuel Friedman will join us to talk about his new book, but also what the senators from Wisconsin had to say about that entire process. So look for that interview on Wednesday. And if you can't catch that on Wednesday, then again, we hope that you will tune in as part of a podcast or listen on the website whenever you're able to. So we're going to be talking about Hans Breitenmoser tomorrow and the Wisconsin Farmers Union. We're going to be talking a bit about the latest drought declarations, the assistance that's being provided to farmers in certain Wisconsin counties. So look for that at 7:30 tomorrow. But coming up at 7:30 today, State Representative Alex Joers will be here to talk about his visit to the White House and the continued push, amazingly, a fight. You have to have a fight for affordable, accessible, quality daycare in Wisconsin. More after this. You're up north. Morning, Alex.
Hey, Pat.
How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you this morning?
I am great, thank you. Very good.
Happy to be here.
Yeah, no, happy to have you here. So this is our longer break. So this is 4 minutes long. So I'm going to check out here at some point and refill the coffee cup, but just wanted to say good morning here. And so I'm going to put you back into the waiting room just so that you don't have to be quiet here. Otherwise, people on Facebook can still hear and see us. So I will pop you back up here in about 2 minutes.
Okay, sounds all good.
Be right back. All righty, we're going to get going here in about 20 seconds.
All right.
Representative Alex Joers represents the 79th Assembly District, which is part of the city of Madison and Middleton, Wanakee. Let's see, there's Westport, Windsor, Burke, all in there as well. Elected to the State Assembly in 2022, formerly on the Dane County Board, and can also add a visit to the White House on his list of things done. It's the one thing he got done in terms of a trip. What he'd really like to get done is making childcare a bit more affordable and accessible in Wisconsin. And that was the subject of goings on at the White House. And so Representative Joers joins us now. Alex, good morning. Thanks for being here.
Good morning, Pat. It's great to be here with you on a Monday morning.
Yeah. Now, so let's talk about the White House trip, and then we'll get into the more serious issues about, you know, why you were there. But how does that come about? How does a state representative find out that, you know, your advocacy is leading to having you join folks from around the country at the White House?
Sure. Well, I think that I was speaking about this issue on the assembly floor during our budget talks, and I got rather frustrated when my Republican colleagues were not interested in funding childcare in our upcoming budget, and we're in the process of cutting it out. So I made a rather passionate speech about the subject and how the $340 million that we were going to use to keep our childcare industry stable in Wisconsin was instead going to be used for tax cuts for folks making over $500,000. So I got agitated about that, and I'm not sure if somebody from the White House was watching or what happened, but a week later or so, I got an invite to come and join a state's convening at the White House to talk about what other states were doing and try and share ideas and also hear about what the administration is doing to lower the cost of childcare.
And that's an important point about that. It's not just that the Wisconsin legislature is doing this, but of course the Biden administration and leaders in other states as well. I frame this as an ongoing and a puzzling fight for affordable childcare. As I mentioned, teasing this at the top of the show, I had to keep the tease rather short because otherwise I'd have to write more about how historians are going to look back on the year 2023 and try to figure out why Republicans are against accessible, affordable, quality childcare, and against affordable health care, and against good wages, and against fighting pollution. But they are boycotting Barbies. They are shooting cans of Bud Light. They're banning rainbows. So I guess U.S. politics is equally bad, you know, for folks that don't really want to pay close attention to this. I don't expect you to answer the question. I have to ask it anyway, because you listen to the floor speeches in the state assembly. What's the beef against affordable childcare and the Childcare Counts program? And what do you tell them in response?
Well, look, Pat, this is the top issue that I've heard about since I was elected and sworn in January. Whenever I meet with folks in my office, whether it be parents or providers or even industry leaders, this is the top issue that I hear about. And folks are looking for workers and they're not able to find workers. And it begs the question, why? Well, if we're not able to provide affordable and accessible childcare in our state, we're gonna struggle with finding workers. So that's what I don't understand about why my Republican colleagues won't get on board with making sure that our families has access to this need. But I will say what I heard from my Republican colleagues on the other side. They had said that this was deemed, you know, too expensive, and that even the joint finance co-chair said something like parents should just expect to pay more for quality, and that's just something that they should prepare to do. You know, I think that we have the money. we have the ability to support our families here in Wisconsin. Again, going back to what I said at the beginning, these my Republican colleagues were prepared to give, I think it was $320 million in tax cuts, essentially the same amount that we could have funded childcare accounts. They were prepared to give it to folks making more than $500,000 in Wisconsin. So that's ridiculous to me.
Well, that's the thing about the point that they're making is that, well, parents should just prepare to pay more. And I guess my response is, why aren't we saying that to millionaires and billionaires instead? Is, you know, to live in a quality state like Wisconsin, where we want kids to have a good childcare, you might have to pay a little bit more. And instead, remember, you're spending either way. Tax cuts are spending cuts. You're just deciding we're not gonna spend as much on this priority, so we can spend it to reduce somebody's taxes. And I'm still, again, failing to understand why certain folks aren't seeing the equivalency of that. That you, do you want to make your investment in a millionaire, or do you want to make your investment in the middle class families of your district? Now, we've talked about childcare counts started as federal pandemic relief aid. The federal aid was going to run out, but again, this still appears to be a secret to many Republican legislators, but we had a $7 billion surplus that we could use for this. So I'm still not seeing the actual harm that would have come from using part of the surplus to continue to keep childcare affordable.
Right. I think that this is what folks are asking for. This is what all of our constituents are asking for. It's not just my constituents in the 79th district, although I have heard a lot about it. The Joint Finance Committee went across Wisconsin and heard from Wisconsinites from Eau Claire to Beloit to Superior to Door County. And they all said, providers, parents, and industry leaders, that we need to make childcare affordable and accessible. And I'll say this, as far as the cost of childcare, the cost of childcare has gone up 26% in the last decade. And so when the Joint Finance Co-Chair is saying parents should just expect to pay more, they have already been paying more for childcare. And so I think that's something that we obviously need to do better in Wisconsin. And I'll keep talking about it. I was at the White House talking about it. I'll keep talking about it when I'm going to Doors, which I have been doing this summer. And that's a consistent message that I've heard from people.
And so that's what brought you to the White House, where nearly 100 state level leaders from across the country came in. How would you frame the way things were structured there? Was it I get the impression that there's almost like a level of brainstorming going on there. What are you guys doing in your state? How are you paying for it in your state? What's the federal government going to do? What was it that structured, or were these primarily kind of loose conversations? How would you frame the discussions of affordable child care at the White House?
Sure. Well, I'll say this. We, in those nearly 100 legislators, including myself and Representative Jill Billings in the La Crosse area, we were joined by folks from 41 states across the nation. And it was encouraging to hear what our national leaders are doing and what other states are doing. But it was also hard to hear when we have states that are fully funding childcare and they're talking about, okay, we've now fully funded childcare, so that's it's affordable to folks 200% over the federal poverty level. And now we're looking at seeing how we can make sure that our health, education providers are paid a living wage. So that was something, sorry, my printer is going off right now.
That's all right.
That was something that we heard. So I was able to bring ideas back to my colleagues here in Wisconsin, talking about what states like California are doing, states like what Minnesota are doing, and making sure that their early education workforce is being paid what they deserve, so, and what they need for quality education and childcare. So that was what I was hearing.
And it's not just states, it's other countries. Pretty much every other developed country is doing more you know, we call it childcare, and people think it's just, you know, kids are, you know, playing with toys or whatnot. It's early childhood. It's early childhood education and early childhood development that other countries have figured out is a good investment. And so can you talk a bit more about that end of it, that you're not, this is not babysitting money. This is an investment in the development of our children and frankly, of our work, of our future workforce as well, right?
Right. And I think that we have to realize that if we're investing in our kids from birth to 3 years old, that investment is going to be seen very clearly in their future years, in income return, in economic development. These are things that we need to think about, where you're right, it's not just kids going to a place to hang out for a while. This is something that, you know, parents need, but then also the kids that are, you know, we're investing in are really going to benefit from the development that we see at this stage in their lives. I have a 3-year-old right now, and the vocabulary that he has developed because he's able to go to a place with invested educators and invested you know, students his age are just incredible. So that's something that I want to see across the state.
And the reason we're still talking about it today, even though the state budget is done, that debate's over, the governor has signed it and applied some partial vetoes. We talk about it because there are still things that can be done about this. Even though the state budget is done, there remains a budget surplus, even a larger one now because of the partial vetoes made by Governor Tony Evers. And so he essentially extended an invitation to Republicans who lead the legislature to say, hey, come on back in the fall session and let's rework that income tax cut so it's not so heavily skewed toward the wealthy. And we still have ways that we can make childcare more affordable and do a host of other things. I'm going to admit I'm pessimistic that any of that's going to happen. So I'll be the pessimist. You can go ahead and be the optimist. What's the best case scenario this fall if a few more Republicans actually start listening to their constituents rather than their leaders?
Well, I think my Republican colleagues are going to have a lot of pressure on them this fall, as 25% of childcare centers are looking at closing this year because of the lack of funding childcare counts is getting. So we're going to keep, my colleagues and I are going to keep going around Wisconsin and making sure that the voices of those who are looking at a closed childcare facility are being heard. It's going to be tough for parents when they have to either look at leaving the workforce or paying a huge amount of their income in childcare costs. So I think that my Republican colleagues are going to start hearing more and more about that. I think I was just looking at some numbers just in my county of Dane County. Two childcare providers just closed last month. This number is even more drastic if you go outside of this county. I think that over half of Wisconsin is in a childcare desert where there's not enough childcare, it's not affordable. So I think that my Republican colleagues are going to start hearing that. I would say to your listeners, Pat, if folks have a story about childcare and or lack of childcare, that they should share that with their legislator. Even if it's me, I'll be able to take that story and share that with my colleagues and make sure that they're hearing it consistently until we fund childcare across Wisconsin.
And I've got less than a minute left, but I know you also put forward an op-ed a couple of weeks back about the short-sightedness of Republicans cutting funding for the UW system because of this temper tantrum about diversity, equity, and inclusion programming. So in just a couple of seconds, do you feel like those programs can be properly defended and adequately funded in the future?
Well, look, I think just like you said, we're at one side cutting childcare funding for 0 to 3. And then the other side, we're taking the future of our workforce, the UW system, and saying that we're going to cut $32 million from them as well. I think that if we want to make sure that we have the workers for the future, if we want to make sure that people are staying in Wisconsin and seeking out Wisconsin as a home state that they want to live in. We need to fund both of these things, and especially the UW system. DEI programs support veterans, first-year college students. These things are, they impact everybody. So we need to fund DEI programs. Fortunately, the governor's veto restored those 188 positions.
But still, you still got that overall cut, which is something that's got to be jumped on. Representative Alex Joers, it's always great to talk to you. Come back again soon. Have a great day.
Thanks, Pat. Great to be with you.
All right. Terry Bell up next with three things you need to know to start the week. You're up north. There we go. All right. Alex, thank you so much. It was great to talk to you.
Yeah, thanks, Pat. Have a great morning.
All right. You too. See you later.
Terry, do you want to join from the studio?
Sure. That's an option.
It's always an option. Get on over there.
All right, here I go.
Well, that cuts down on the crawl.
Yeah, it does, huh?
Bad echo. Make sure your mic's off in there.
How do I do that?
Huh. All right.
There you go.
Not bad.
Yeah.
How was the weekend?
It was very good. Thank you. Good. Very nice. All right, here we go. 5 seconds. We normally play a tune from the old 97s for Terry Bell, Civic Media News Director, who joins us Mondays to tell us about three things you should know. Aaron, you're here to tell me you didn't violate that at all, that it's just a different song.
It's just another one. This one is called Oppenheimer.
I see what you did there. Okay, very nice. Well, let's get into that with Terry Bell. First off, we've never really talked about your fandom of the old 97s. Where did that come from?
Well, just being exposed to them, gosh, they first made a splash in the 90s. In fact, I think they were featured in a Vince Vaughn, Jennifer Aniston romantic comedy, I think at some point in a scene. But they just sort of kept showing up, and my friends kept recommending them. And they tour quite a bit, and they get to Wisconsin about once a year. So I started going to shows. They are a great live band. They are great entertainers. They put on a heck of a show, and I've been a fan ever since.
Nice. Okay. And then of course the Oppenheimer, the title of that tune leads me to ask, what did you think of the Barbie movie? Or maybe you saw Oppenheimer. I'm not sure.
I didn't see either one. I plan to see Oppenheimer this upcoming weekend, and I may very well stream the Barbie movie. I hear it's actually pretty clever, as a pretty smart movie. So I may see it one way or the other. Yeah.
I think that, I mean, it was one thing for me to hear, yeah, the Barbie movie. And then you say, you say Greta Gerwig, and I go, okay, I don't know all my film directors. I'm not, you know, the fan, but I know that she's won enough accolades and such that this is not going to be some kind of a throwaway. It's going to be, you know, clever, smart, funny. And so I'm not surprised that it's being so well received.
I'm not terribly surprised either, but it you know, just from reading things, it could have gone either way in terms of whether this was going to be something that adults could enjoy or whether this was just going to be fluff. And I guess it has some things to say, and it says it in a very clever way, and that appeals to me. So I think I'll check it out at some point.
And that is the main thing. If you want something geared toward kids that still is going to do well, you give the adults a little something. You throw a little something their way that's not going to be too mature for the kids. They might miss it entirely, but the adults will go, oh, okay, yep, I like that. Thanks for thinking about me. Mm-hmm. Let's get into three things you should know to start the week, as told by Civic Media's news director. And let's start with the fact that a soldier with ties to Racine, a last report, continues to be in North Korea. At least we think so. Has anybody heard anything since he dashed across the border last week?
Absolutely, yes. Actually, there's an update on that. North Korea says it is in talks with the United Nations, the U.S.-led United Nations force in North Korea. So those talks are underway about getting Private King back to the United States one way or the other. This is the first acknowledgement from North Korea of any of this since then. It's been almost a week now that a Private King apparently, instead of boarding a plane, ran to the demilitarized zone, blended in with a tour group, and then bolted to the other side of that border, which it would be fascinating to know his thought process. He was on his way back to the United States to face disciplinary action. So you could imagine, I don't want to make any assumptions, but you know, in his mind, he may have been thinking he was escaping the consequences of some trouble he'd gotten into earlier. But then he, you know, ends up in North Korea. I don't think if he had thought that through, that would have been the choice he made.
No, you're right. It's absolutely in the did you really think this one through as far as what you were going to have next? All right. Well, the fight to defend democracy goes on, and that includes, you know, going after efforts to suppress democracy and voters, whether it's in district lines or the way and the manner in which people can vote. What's new on the democracy front?
Well, there is a lawsuit that will, in all likelihood, go before the Wisconsin Supreme Court at some point, as we've been talking about for quite some time now. The ideological majority on the court will switch on August 1st when Janet Protasiewicz is sworn in. And so there's a lot of anticipation about rulings that will come. And a group called the Elias Law Group, a national democratic law firm, has now filed a lawsuit seeking to change some rules that the current, soon-to-be former Supreme Court enacted concerning drop boxes. They made absentee ballot drop boxes illegal. They also required witness signatures on absentee ballots and required that mistakes on ballots be corrected by 8 o'clock on election day. That was the current court. The lawsuit anticipates that the next court would overrule those things, and that's what the lawsuit seeks to do to, you know, make voting more open again. These changes were made during the pandemic that the Supreme Court overturned, saying that they were no longer needed and that perhaps that the Wisconsin Elections Commission overstepped its bounds. The lawsuit says that actually these are, these make voting accessible for everybody, are legal and perfectly fair to enact, and that's what this lawsuit seeks to do. It's going to be the first of several things that come up. People anticipate that this next Supreme Court is going to take on a raft of issues right away. That's not going to be the case. There are a lot of things that this court will take up, but it'll be a trickle. It won't be a rush.
Yeah, exactly. All right, now our third thing to know about to start the week is that there have been new natural disaster designations from the U.S. Department of Agriculture and the Secretary of Agriculture due to not drought, but drought-like conditions. And that means that the farmers in some counties are going to be able to have some emergency credit extended, because we talked about the smoke and haze earlier this hour, Terry, but the dryness itself is still hanging on quite stubbornly.
It sure is. And at least for farmers in all or part of 27 counties, they may get some help if they've seen significant losses due to 8 or more straight weeks of drought conditions during their growing season. So those farmers have until March 18th to apply for some help there. And this would come in the form of emergency credit and loans. I'm not seeing any word of any grants or anything like that. But this would be something, a lifeline to help these farmers who, experienced, got way behind on the progress of their crops. I have to say, driving around southern Wisconsin this weekend, I was very encouraged by what I saw in terms of just, the appearance of the crops to a guy like me, a layman. Certainly, it hasn't changed the fact that farmers suffered greatly.
Oh, yeah. This summer. And very much varies. It can vary from county to county. And if you want to learn more, go to farmers.gov from the U.S. Department of Agriculture to learn if this might impact you. Terry Bell, thank you so much. Great to start the week with you. Have a great day.
Thank you, Pat.
All right. And that's going to do it for us here. We'll have Hans Breitenmoser on tomorrow to talk about some of the latest about the drought-like conditions that we continue to have here. Remember, you can follow us on our website, upnorthnewswi.com and upnorthnewswi on social media. Have a great Monday. We'll see you back here tomorrow from up here on the lake, where it's always a beautiful day up north.
All right. Adios.
See ya.